the key findings were that the available local observations or observational data does indicate that there is strong evidence for enhanced warming at high elevations. However, and there were also a number of mechanisms that are thought to contribute to this. One of the key ones is for regions that experience seasonal snow cover, the retreat of the seasonal snow line leads to a radiative feedback. And the other key mechanisms are primarily focused on the behavior of water vapor in a warming atmosphere. So regions that do and do not have snow cover will experience slightly different versions of enhanced high elevation warming, but both can be expected to.
What the research has found is that we need a lot more monitoring in high elevation regions. There's really not very much monitoring at all at the moment. There's very few stations over 3,000 metres, only one above 5,000 metres, and that's only got a 10-year record on the top of Mount Kilimanjaro. And actually, that's the main reason is because these places are so inaccessible. I mean, some places are more accessible rather than others. Places like the Alps, obviously the Himalayas, very difficult to get into. Some places dangerous as well, in terms of personal safety, and you need to have some mountaineering skills quite often to actually get in and to actually collect data. Some of the things though that might be interesting in this regard is things like telemetered systems, the fact you can put automatic gauges in there now that can then send information back to satellites, etc. So as well as the need for better monitoring, the research also suggested that we need other things, like, for example, using different data sets, so we can use information from satellites, information from reanalyses, and climate models. There's been a recent development in climate modelling using very high resolution simulations that were previously used for forecasting, and actually using these type of models over mountainous regions would be able to give us information on the processes, and in terms of telling us what processes were actually causing elevation dependent warming, and this increased warming that we're seeing at these high elevations would be quite exciting.
These high elevation regions are often the areas which contribute tremendous amounts of volume to downstream rivers. So there are two categories of affected people in these regions. There are people who live in the high mountains themselves, which often have activities based on the natural ecosystems and on farming, and rapid climate change in these areas can affect the natural processes and farming upon which these people's livelihoods depend. Although these regions are often sparsely populated, so the actual absolute numbers of people experiencing these changes are limited, the changes could be quite drastic. In terms of sheer numbers, hundreds of millions of people live in river basins downstream of these high elevation areas, and the rapid warming of these regions could affect the timing of river flows and the volume of water available for human activities, including irrigated agriculture and municipal water supply.